Good morning. This is Dr. Adel Bondok, Professor of Anatomy and Neuroscience, Mansoura University, Egypt. Today I will talk about the nasal cavity, the nasopharynx, and the oropharynx. Starting with the nasal cavity, I will talk about the boundaries of the nasal cavity, structures opening in the lateral wall. This is the lateral wall. Then I will talk about the nerve supply, arterial supply, and the paranasal sinuses. Start by the boundaries of the nasal cavity. This is the nasal cavity, and this is the nasal septum, separating the two sides, or separating the two nasal cavities. Okay, the nasal cavity has a roof. This is the roof of the nasal cavity. Okay, the roof is divided into three parts. Anterior part, this one. And the anterior part is formed of three structures. This one is the nasal cartilage. This one is the nasal bone. And this one is the frontal bone and the frontal ear sinus. So the anterior part of the roof, nasal cartilage, nasal bone, and the frontal bone. The middle part, this one, is the cribriform plate of ethmoid. And the posterior part, this one, is the body of the sphenoid and the sphenoid ear sinus. Okay, body of the sphenoid bone and the sphenoid ear sinus. Then the floor, this is the floor, is formed of the hard palate. And this hard palate is formed of two bones, maxilla and the palatine bones. The medial wall of the nasal cavity is the nasal septum. And in order to see the lateral wall, I have to remove the nasal septum. Again, this is the nasal cavity and this is the nasal septum. So this is the roof. Okay, anterior part of the roof, three structures, nasal cartilage, nasal bone, frontal bone. The middle part is the cribriform plate of ethmoid, and the posterior part is the body of the sphenoid and the sphenoid ear sinus. This is the floor, hard palate, formed of maxilla and the palatine bone. The medial wall is the nasal septum, and the nasal septum is formed of three structures. The anterior part is formed of nasal septal cartilage. The posterior part is formed by the vomer, and the upper part is formed by the perpendicular plate of ethmoid. This is the lateral wall of the nasal cavity. It shows three elevations called the nasal conchae: superior concha, middle concha, and the inferior concha. And then a space below each concha called the meatus. So there are three meatuses: superior meatus, middle meatus, and the inferior meatus. Actually, the superior concha and the middle concha are processes of the ethmoid bone. The inferior concha is a separate bone of the skull. We have a space here between the sphenoid and the superior concha, and this space is called sphenoethmoidal recess. Again, the lateral wall, three elevations called the nasal conchae. These three elevations are important to increase the surface area of the nasal cavity. Okay, superior concha, middle concha, inferior concha. Superior and the middle are processes of the ethmoid. Inferior concha is a separate bone of the skull. Three meatuses, superior, middle, and inferior, and the sphenoethmoidal recess. Again, this is the lateral wall. This is the superior concha. This is the middle concha. This is the bone, and this is the mucous membrane. This is the inferior concha, the bone covered by mucous membrane. Okay, so this is the superior meatus. Three meatuses. Superior meatus, this one. Middle meatus. And the inferior meatus. And this space is the sphenosmoidal recess. The middle meatus contains several features. This elevation is called bulla ethmoidalis. And this bulla ethmoidalis is formed by the middle ethmoidal air sinus. Below the bulla, there is a groove. This groove is called hiatus semilunaris. Hiatus semilunaris ends by this funnel-shaped structure called the infundibulum. Again, the lateral wall contains three conchae, superior, middle, and inferior, three meatuses, superior meatus, middle meatus, inferior meatus, sphenoethmoidal recess. The middle meatus contains elevation called bulla ethmoidalis, contains a groove called the hiatus semilunaris, and this funnel-shaped space is called the infundibulum. Now, structures opening in the lateral wall of the nasal cavity. Structures opening in the lateral wall of the nasal cavity are nasal sinuses and nasolacrimal duct. So, sphenoethmoidal recess contains the opening of the sphenoidal air sinus. Superior meatus, opening of the posterior ethmoidal sinus. Actually, there are three ethmoidal sinuses. The posterior one opens in the superior meatus. Then in the middle meatus, we have the opening of four sinuses. Middle ethmoidal sinus opens on the bulla. Anterior ethmoidal sinus opens in the anterior part of the hiatus semilunaris. And this is the opening of the maxillary ear sinus. In the posterior part of the hiatus semilunaris, and this is the opening of the frontal ear sinus in the infundibulum. Therefore, the middle meatus contains four openings: middle ethmoidal sinus on the bulla, anterior ethmoidal sinus in the anterior part of the hiatus semilunaris, maxillary sinus in the posterior part of the hiatus semilunaris, and the frontal ear sinus in the infundibulum. In the inferior meatus, only one opening, which is the nasolacrimal duct. Again, structures opening in the lateral wall of the nose. We have four spaces: sphenoethmoidal recess, superior meatus, middle meatus, and inferior meatus. In the sphenoethmoidal recess, we have the sphenoidal ear sinus. In the superior meatus, we have the posterior ethmoidal sinus. In the middle meatus, we have four: middle ethmoidal sinus in the bulla, anterior ethmoidal sinus in the anterior part of the hiatus, maxillary ear sinus in the posterior part of the hiatus semilunaris, and the frontal ear sinus in the infundibulum. And in the inferior meatus, there is the nasolacrimal duct, opening of the nasolacrimal duct. The nerve supply of the nose. Nerve supply of the nose, I will talk about three structures. Talk about the skin, the nasal septum, and the lateral wall. Regarding the skin of the nose, the skin of the nose is supplied by three nerves. This one is the infratrochlear nerve, branch from the ophthalmic nerve, or actually branch from the nasociliary branch of the ophthalmic nerve. This is the second one, external nasal branch. And this external nasal nerve is branched from the nasociliary of the ophthalmic nerve. And this one is the infraorbital nerve from the maxillary nerve. Then the nasal septum. Nasal septum is supplied by three nerves. The upper part by the olfactory nerves. The anterior part by the anterior ethmoidal nerve from the nasociliary of the ophthalmic nerve. And the posterior part is the nasopalatine nerve. Nasopalatine nerve from the sphenopalatine ganglion of the maxillary nerve. And this nasopalatine carries secretory fibers to the nasal glands. Okay, again, so the nasal septum. Upper part by olfactory nerves, anterior part by anterior ethmoidal nerve, posterior part by the nasociliary nasopalatine nerve. Regarding the lateral wall of the nasal cavity, again three nerves, the upper part by the olfactory nerves, the anterior part by the anterior ethmoidal, from the nasociliary, from the ophthalmic, and the remaining part of the lateral wall by nasal branches of sphenopalatine ganglion and the nasal branches of the greater palatine nerve. These nasal branches carry secretory fibers to the nasal glands. Therefore, the nasal cavity is supplied by four nerves. The upper part of the septum and the lateral wall by the olfactory nerves, the anterior part of the septum and the lateral wall by the anterior ethmoidal nerve, the posterior part of the septum by the nasopalatine, and the posterior part of the lateral wall by the nasal branches of the sphenopalatine ganglion and the greater palatine nerve. Now the arterial supply of the nasal cavity. The nasal cavity is supplied by six arteries. Two arteries from the ophthalmic artery, two arteries from the maxillary artery, the third part, and two arteries from the facial artery. The two arteries from the ophthalmic artery are anterior ethmoidal and posterior ethmoidal. From the maxillary artery, sphenopalatine and greater palatine, and the sphenopalatine artery is the main arterial supply to the nasal cavity. From the facial artery, we have two branches. Lateral nasal, supplying the skin, and the septal branch of the superior labial artery. So the six arteries supplying the nasal cavity, two from the ophthalmic artery, anterior ethmoidal and posterior ethmoidal, two from the third part of the maxillary artery, sphenopalatine and the greater palatine, and the two from the facial artery, lateral nasal artery and the septal branch of the superior labial artery. Again, this is the nasal cavity. Okay, nasal cavity supplied by five arteries and the skin by one more artery, the lateral nasal. So this one is the anterior ethmoidal artery. This one is the posterior ethmoidal artery. The two arteries are branches from the ophthalmic artery. This one is the sphenopalatine artery. And this one is the greater palatine artery. Sphenopalatine and the greater palatine are branches from the third part of the maxillary artery. This one is the septal branch of the superior labial artery. This area is called Little's area of epistaxis. And this little area of epistaxis is the area of anastomosis between three arteries, anterior ethmoidal, sphenopalatine, and the septal branch of the superior labial. Then let us talk about epistaxis. Epistaxis is bleeding from the nasal cavity. Then we'll talk about little the area. What is little the area? Little the area is the area of epistaxis. Where is it? It is in the anteroinferior part of the nasal septum. This is the anteroinferior part of the nasal septum. Anterior part and the inferior part. Anteroinferior part of the nasal septum. It is the area of anastomosis of three arteries. Anterior sphenoidal artery, sphenopalatine artery, and the septal branch of the superior labial artery. Paranasal sinuses. Paranasal sinuses are air-filled cavities in some bones of the skull. What are the bones of the skull which contain air-filled cavities? Sphenoid, frontal, ethmoid, and maxillary bone. So nasal sinuses are sphenoidal air sinus in the body of the sphenoid, this one. Then frontal air sinus in the frontal bone. Maxillary air sinus in the maxilla. And the three ethmoidal sinuses in the ethmoid bone. And the three ethmoidal sinuses, anterior, middle, and posterior. You should know where these sinuses open in the nasal cavity. Okay. Frontal ear sinus opens in the infundibulum in the middle meatus. Ethmoidal sinuses are three. The posterior ethmoidal sinus in the superior meatus. The middle ethmoidal and anterior ethmoidal in the middle meatus. Middle ethmoidal in the pulla. Anterior ethmoidal in the anterior part of the hiatus semilunaris. Then maxillary ear sinus. This maxillary ear sinus opens in the middle meatus in the posterior part of the hiatus semilunaris. And number four, this one, sphenoidal ear sinus, which opens into the sphenoethmoidal recess. Again, these are the cavities filled with air. This is the frontal ear sinus opening into the infundibulum. These are the ethmoidal sinuses. The posterior ethmoidal opens in the superior meatus. The middle ethmoidal opens in the bulla. The anterior ethmoidal opens in the anterior part of the hiatus semilunaris. This is the sphenoid ear sinus, which opens in the sphenoethmoidal recess. And this is the opening of the maxillary sinus, opens in the posterior part of the hiatus semilunaris. What are the functions of the nasal sinuses? What are the functions of the cavities filled with air? Of course, number one, they decrease the weight of the skull. Number two, they make the voice resonant. They increase the surface area for the air. Air-filled spaces actually are air conditioning of the head. And they absorb shocks in cases of face trauma. What is the clinical importance of the paranasal sinuses? Infection in the paranasal sinuses can spread to the neighboring structures. So frontal sinusitis can extend to the cranial cavity, causing brain abscess, subdural abscess, or meningitis. Ethmoidal sinusitis can extend to the orbit causing orbital abscess, and this orbital abscess can extend to the cranial cavity causing again brain abscess or meningitis. The pharynx is a muscular tube. This is a muscular tube. It is about 5 inches long. It extends from the base of the skull. It is located in front of the upper 6 cervical vertebrae. This is the axis, and this is the odontoid process of the axis, which is actually the body of the atlas. So the pharynx is 5 inches long, located in front of the upper 6 cervical vertebrae. It extends from the base of the skull till C6. So the end of the pharynx is opposite C6, and the beginning of the esophagus is opposite C6. The pharynx is related anteriorly to 3 cavities: nasal cavity, oral cavity, and the larynx. Is related posteriorly to the upper 6 thoracic vertebrae, and it is divided into 3 parts or 3 divisions. The part behind the nose, this part, is the nasopharynx. The part behind the oral cavity is the oropharynx, and the part behind the larynx is the laryngopharynx. Again, divisions of the pharynx. This part behind the nose is the nasopharynx. This part behind the oral cavity is the oropharynx. And this part behind the larynx is the laryngopharynx. And the pharynx continues downward as the esophagus. Again, looking at the pharynx from behind, this is the nasal cavity. This is the vomer, inferior concha, superior concha. So this area here is the nasopharynx. And this area is the oropharynx. And here is the laryngopharynx, and it continues downward as the esophagus. Okay, let us talk about the nasopharynx. This is the nasopharynx, and this is the oropharynx. Regarding the nasopharynx, the roof and the posterior wall contains a collection of lymphoid tissue. It's called the adenoid or pharyngeal tonsil. So this is the pharyngeal tonsil or adenoid in the roof and the posterior wall of the nasopharynx. The floor is a soft palate. The anterior wall, this one, is the posterior nasal orifice. And the lateral wall contains some features. This is the first one. Lateral wall contains. This is the opening of the auditory tube or opening of Eustachian tube, guarded by tubal elevation formed by the cartilage. And then a muscle extending downward from the tube to the pharynx, salpingopharyngeal fold, containing salpingopharyngeous muscle, and then pharyngeal recess. So the features in the lateral wall: Eustachian tube, opening of the auditory tube, tubal elevation formed by the cartilage, salpingopharyngeal fold formed by salpingopharyngeous muscle, and the pharyngeal recess. Again, the nasopharynx, roof and posterior roll, collection of lymphoid tissue called the adenoid or pharyngeal tonsil, floor, soft palate, anterior roll, posterior nasal orifice, and the lateral wall, opening of the auditory tube or eustachian tube, tubal elevation, salpingopharyngeal fold, pharyngeal recess. Therefore, enlargement of the adenoid can obstruct the posterior nasal orifice, leading to oral breathing. Okay? Then the oropharynx. This is the main feature in the oropharynx. This one, which is the palatine tonsil. This palatine tonsil is located behind this fold, between the palate and the tongue, palatoglossal arch, and is located in front of another fold between the palate and the pharynx, palatopharyngeal fold. Therefore, the oropharynx contains palatine tonsil between two arches, palatoglossal arch anterior and palatopharyngeal arch posterior. Then regarding the palatine tonsil in the oropharynx, it is located in this fossa, it's called the tonsillar fossa. This tonsillar fossa is bounded anteriorly by this fold, palatoglossal arch. This fold, palatoglossal arch, containing palatoglossus muscle, is bounded posteriorly by this arch or fold, palatopharyngeal arch, containing palatopharyngeous muscle, and the bed is formed by the superior constrictor muscle. This one. The palatine tonsil is rich in arterial supply. About 5 arteries supplying the palatine tonsil, 2 from the facial artery, tonsillar branch, which is the main supply, another branch from the facial artery, ascending palatine artery, branch from the external carotid artery, ascending pharyngeal, branch from the lingual artery, dorsal lingual artery, and the branch from the lesser palatine artery. So the palatine tonsil is supplied by 5 arteries, tonsillar branch from the facial artery, ascending palatine branch of the facial artery, ascending pharyngeal artery from the external carotid artery, dorsal lingual arteries from the lingual artery, and the great and the lesser palatine artery from the greater palatine artery. Therefore, bleeding after tonsillectomy is common. Okay? Nerve supply of the tonsil. The main nerve supply, this is the glossopharyngeal nerve, and this is the tonsillar branch of the glossopharyngeal nerve. So glossopharyngeal nerve and the lesser palatine nerve. Lymph drainage, upper deep cervical lymph nodes, which are called jugulodigastric lymph nodes. I will talk about them when talking about the lymph drainage of the head and the neck. Again, this is the tonsillar fossa. Tonsillar fossa is bounded anteriorly by this arch, palatoglossal arch. Okay, palatoglossal arch anterior, formed by the palatoglossus muscle, bounded posteriorly by the palatopharyngeal arch containing palatopharyngeous muscle, and the floor is formed by the superior constrictor muscle. These arteries pierce the superior constrictor to supply the tonsil. Remember, 5 arteries. Facial artery gives you 2 branches, tonsillar branch and ascending palatine. External carotid artery gives ascending pharyngeal. Lingual artery gives the dorsal lingual arteries and the lesser palatine artery. And the palatine tonsil is supplied by branch from the glossopharyngeal nerve, tonsillar branch. This is acute follicular tonsillitis. Palatine tonsil, acute follicular tonsillitis. This is the palatoglossal arch anterior. And this is the palatoglossal pharyngeal arch posterior. And this is the uvula. Again, this is the palatine tonsil. This palatine tonsil is located between palatoglossal arch anterior, this one, and palatopharyngeal arch posterior. Palatoglossal arch and palatopharyngeal arch. Now, lymph drainage of the pharynx. The pharynx is drained by retropharyngeal lymph nodes and deep cervical lymph nodes. There is a ring around the pharynx. It's called the Waldeyer's ring. So Waldeyer's ring is a ring of lymphoid tissue around the pharynx. This Waldeyer's ring is formed by four tonsils. Anteriorly, the lingual tonsil, then the palatine tonsil on each side, tubal tonsil on each side, and the pharyngeal tonsil in the posterior upper part. Again, Waldeyer's ring is a ring of lymphoid tissue around the pharynx. So we have the adenoid in the roof of the nasopharynx. Then tubal tonsil around the opening of the auditory tube. Then palatine tonsil on each side of the oropharynx. And the lingual tonsil in the posterior third of the tongue. So this is the Waldeyer's ring of lymphoid tissue. And thank you very much, and good luck, and have a nice day.